Hi, I'm Dr. Rajani. Do you want to know some secrets of hyaluronic acid, the so-called youth juice, how you can use it orally, topically, and injected to keep your skin youthful, plump, and vibrant without breaking the bank? Join me in this video. Now remember, if you like these and find them useful, subscribe. And today's topic, hyaluronic acid, almost everyone knows about it because it's kind of a catchword. There's a lot of misconceptions we're going to talk about, but it's in skincare. It can cost hundreds of dollars topically. We also know it can be ingested, and certainly it can be injected for lip fillers and plumping the face. How can that be? How can it be used in all those different forms? What should you be doing? Let's tackle, first of all, what it is. Hyaluronic acid is a glycosaminoglycan, so it's kind of a sugar, but what it does is it attracts water. It's a humectant, so it can attract 1,000 times its weight in water so that it plumps things up. Now, that can be good or bad. It's found in almost every tissue in our body, but particularly people know it from the skin, the joints, the spine, and it's injected in the knees, for instance, as a shock absorber to help avoid people needing knee replacements and help to cushion any osteoarthritis. And that was one of its first uses, even somewhat before aesthetics that people hear of it from. So how can it be used in all those different forms, and what should you be doing with it? Okay, let's first tackle the topical. So we know it attracts water in. We know it can cost anywhere from $10 to $500. So what are the differences in what you should be doing? Well, first of all, in skin, just like the body, we're making hyaluronic acid all the time. We make it, we break it down, make it and break it down. Just like many processes in the body, we start to break down more than what we can make. And because of that, we end up a little bit deficient, particularly, of course, in the joints and everywhere, but we're talking about the skin. So you think, well, we'll just replace that, right? Not so fast, not so simple. First of all, topically, if we just put it on the skin, it has to get somewhere. So it has to be absorbed. And this is the first tip in all of this is, there's different sizes, and skincare companies for everything, peptides and retinols and everything, are trying to work on delivery mechanisms to get it deep into the tissues. And that's the holy grail. If we can find that out, well, maybe we wouldn't need to have it injected. And just like that hyaluronic pen where they're trying to blast non-cross-linked HA into lips and into the skin at various levels to plump it, there might be vehicles that deliver it in, such as proteins and messenger proteins, but it doesn't quite exist now. So we know there are small and large molecules of hyaluronic acid, and people tout different ones. But my tip to you, number one, is get an inexpensive product that is, you can use a pure hyaluronic acid. I'm going to talk about skin cream incorporation later, but a lot of people, and I tend to like once in a while using a pure form that has several sizes, small, medium, and large. The smaller ones are certainly going to have a better chance of absorbing deeper, and in general, deeper is better. Topical isn't going to help you with much, and as you know, if you use straight from a bottle, when you put it on, it has this kind of drying effect at first. It can feel a little bit stiff. So the tip number two is you're going to see sodium hyaluronate as well as hyaluronic acid. Well, what's that? Some people tell you, well, it's the same thing. Sodium, referring to a salt, sodium hyaluronate is better absorbed. So does it mean it's better? Well, probably the answer is both. You want a multiple size hyaluronic acid, preferably at least with small molecules. So if you have to choose one or another, typically the smaller ones are more expensive, along with the sodium hyaluronate. They both work and can work at different levels. But look for both ingredients and you'll often find them. That's another tip. So get both of those. Now, in terms of delivery into the skin, Would you first of all, there's creams. So you're going to find hyaluronic acid in your creams, in your moisturizers, in everything else. I do like I said, having a dedicated serum. Every once in a while, you're going to use that. It might be regularly, but it might be every other day or maybe once or twice a week. Put on the serum, knowing that the other days you have it in your creams. Depending on the cream and what's in there, you might not get a lot of absorption of the hyaluronic acid, and thus having the pure form, you can mix it up. Now, when you have different forms, do you ever get a new skin cream and you put it on, you go, oh my gosh, I love it. And then about a month or two later, you lose your love a little bit. You try something different and you love that one now. Part of that is your skin is seeing something different and it's absorbing nutrients. Even though, say, one might be a hyaluronic acid and another hyaluronic acid, say with vitamin C, something like that. There's different formulations, different types of vitamin C, vitamin C esters, different things that are mixed in. Or your skin cream, your moisturizer, may not be allowing the large molecules, but the small molecules are absorbing. So having both and playing around with your skin creams, it's a good thing. It allows for absorption of different nutrients. So even if you have it in other creams, having a pure form, I think, is worthwhile. Okay, so the next natural question is, what formulation? Should I have a serum or a cream? It's already in a lot of creams. I think serums have better absorption. They can be a little more expensive, but remember, if you just use as your first step after cleansing, don't worry about having hyaluronic acid in your cleanser. That's overkill, and your cleanser's not meant to hydrate anyway. But after clean skin, while it's damp, using the serum is my preference, and let it be in your skincare. They don't charge that much more for it, and it's in there anyway, because everyone wants to say it has hyaluronic acid in it, even though it might be minimal. Another little secret, all your skincare, almost all of it, is going to have glycerin, and glycerin's a humectant that works wonderfully as well, attracts water, and moisturizes. It's why a lot of these products can say instant results, look younger instantly, because it plumps rather instantly. But again, remember, you need to get that water from somewhere. The last thing is, a lot of people don't talk about it, but hyaluronic acid is indeed an antioxidant. It's a free radical scavenger. So you're not just using it for water. Some people say, well, how can it be anti-aging? Because it doesn't build collagen or promote collagen production. It just plumps. Not quite true. It has antioxidant benefits that can work very, very well. So a little secret no one talks about that much, which really brings us in to the second part of this whole discussion, which is taking it orally. So if it works so well on the skin, should we be bathing in it and eating it? Okay, there are supplements on the market. They cost a lot of money, and they tout many things. Let's go back to why people think that if you ingest it, it works. Well, there's several reasons, but one of the most interesting one, and you should read up on this a little bit, there's a small area in Japan where the people tend to live over the age of 85. Not only do they live long, they look great, and their quality of life is excellent up until the end. And that's one of the goals of life, is not having a long illness phase. And there are people there, many people live over the age of 100. So studies have been done to see what's different about this area in Japan that's different from the big cities, even in the same country where they might be exposed to similar environmental factors. One of the common denominators was the diet of the people in this town where people did so well with longevity, ate a diet rich in products that have, or plants that had, hyaluronic acid, particularly a type of root or potato. So should we just get this and eat it, and can we take it in a supplement form? Well, go read more. I'll put some information on that town because it's fascinating. But they tried to make supplements out of it. Let's start on the supplement side. The supplements, there's no real good data to say that they help. They, whether it be at longevity or your skin. Some people tout them, but remember, the stomach is there to break down food to prevent infection, and the acidity doesn't really allow absorption into the bloodstream of a meaningful form of hyaluronic acid from everything I read, and in my opinion. Read it on your own if you're so inclined, but there's definitely no evidence to support that. There's anecdotal evidence. What does that mean? That means that someone might come into your clinic and say, it worked for me, but remember, placebo works 30 to 40% of the time. So if they took a sugar pill, that might work too. So come off of it. If you liked it and you want to take them, come off of them after a month of using it. See if you notice a difference. Go back on and try it. If it works for you, that's great. What can you do? Well, you can mimic the diet of the people in this town where people live long and healthy. And one of my patients many years ago, this was kind of all over the news, I remember 2009, 2011, they were Japanese, they brought me that potato. And I never really did know how to prepare it, but there's things you can get in your own grocery store that happen to be just the healthy things we normally eat that are high in hyaluronic acid, but also been shown to be healthy. They are potatoes, sweet potatoes, cauliflower, green beans. I'll put a list up here so that you can read the entire list. But they're thought to be healthy products anyway. I would just say make sure you wash them thoroughly. Organic is probably better than things that have been sprayed with Roundup and everything else. But it's a high fiber diet and high in hyaluronic acid. So there's other health benefits to it. But certainly, if you look and you read about that town, it's fascinating that they live longer and what their diet actually is. I think what you take in, just like sleep and other things, are very important to help you with healthy, beautiful, vibrant skin. But the supplements, sorry to say, the easy way out probably isn't going to help you. Now the third way, and I'm going to break it up into 3A and 3B. 3A is going to suit the more au naturel people, and I'm not sure why, but you watch and see. The 3A is going to be non-cross-linked, so it's kind of like the hyaluronic acid that you're putting topically, injected in a mesotherapy type of way, and that's intradermal. Meso means middle layer of skin, and therapy means because it's therapeutic. And mesotherapy was initially invented putting certain antioxidants or even aspirin type of drugs and drug delivery systems around the knee by injecting it. So why take an aspirin by mouth when you can inject it around the knee? If you're taking it for the mouth, it's gonna affect the whole body, and you might only want the knee to get better. That's the premise, mesotherapy. Well, in skincare, putting products in the middle layer of skin, such as elements, trace elements, retinols, vitamins, vitamin C, it's been used for many years, especially in France and in Europe. I'm a huge fan of it. And you see it today with little devices that we stamp on the skin, and we can make the skin rejuvenate it and glow. We use MesoGlow in our clinic, or MesoGlow.com. You can research more on that. There's various methods. I still kind of like the old school injection with a nice 33 gauge needle superficially by hand, nappage technique, and sometimes adding platelet rich fiber in your own blood products to the non-cross-linked hyaluronic acid can work very well. I call it plasma boosters. So putting the non-cross-linked hyaluronic acid into the dermis of the skin, a lot of people like that because it's not dermal filler, which we'll talk about. It's actually hydrating the skin, but instead of depending on the small molecular weight hyaluronic acids to get into the skin, you simply take a tiny needle and you barely prick the skin and you put it all over to get it into the skin. Now, hyaluronic acid, the topical, and this non-cross-linked hyaluronic acid that we're nappaging into the skin, it's going to last you anywhere from 2 to 5 days at the most, because hyaluronidase in your body breaks it down. But there's the antioxidant effect, there's the sort of like the body seeing a foreign substance, a slight short-term inflammatory effect, and of course the nutrients that go with it that help invigorate the skin and give it a longer, several week look of rejuvenation. Of course you can use topicals with that, but it's not something you do once a year. It's something you do every month to two by putting these boosters into your skin. And now we go to fillers, which are hyaluronic acid that are cross-linked. And there's a couple different ways to do it. The most common is bacterial cross-linking that forms the fillers we know today, like Restylane and Juvederm, Belotero, the hyaluronic acid fillers that certainly, of course, again, draw water in, that plump the skin, that can be used in a robust manner, deep on the bone, or a little more superficial to do different things and are injected at different levels. So having several different types of hyaluronic acids allows you to use them deep on the bone, more superficial in the fat, and then the lighter ones are just subdermal. So you remember with the mesotherapy type that I talked about, most people would use non-cross-linked hyaluronic acid that goes away in several days to a week. You can also, something in Europe, called skin boosters or Vital Light. Those are actually like Restylane Silk type products, and one would be Vital Light would be half strength Restylane Silk, and those are actually napaged in intradermally as well. So the au naturel people might be like, I don't want the fillers, quote unquote, but I'll do the non-cross-linked skin boosters. But you can actually get skin boosting with a dermal filler, just a light one. So I know it's kind of complex stuff. One of the most important things you can go in to your doctor, your nurse, or practitioner is just go in, find someone you trust that's not there to take your money, and say, what should I do? And it's the topical that we talked about with the tips and tricks around the topical. It's eating healthy and those foods that I listed to get all the antioxidants and hyaluronic acid goodness that you can. And then it's mesotherapy or slight injections, if you will, just superficial injections of the hyaluronic acid that's much like the topical, but of course sterile, to boost the skin with and without your blood product, whichever one. And then finally, it's injection at different levels of cross-linked hyaluronic acid. And the answer is, which one of those do you do? Well, it's really whatever floats your boat. Some people are dead against fillers, and some people would much rather do fillers than topicals and skincare. It's out there. But it's a continuum, and your provider is going to recommend likely topicals, of course the dietary part of it, and some people are going to say use supplements. I just don't buy into them. And then injections, and the mesotherapy part is something that I think we miss in North America because everyone wants the boom boom wow wow long lasting if they're going to have injections, but really it's a nice natural way with slight little injections to plump the skin and have a nice glow to your skin without getting fillers. But if you have a big droop in your face or a hollow, or you need more strength or pull to lift things to add volume or fill grooves and folds or have deep smile lines, you just need a cross-linked hyaluronic acid injected. And no one really wants to look natural. Natural looking means you don't do anything. Sit out in the sun, don't put topical, don't put sunscreen, don't do mesotherapy, don't do injections. If you want natural, you walk into your clinic and you walk out and do nothing, because doing nothing is natural. What it means is you want to look natural, but no one really wants to look really natural. They want to look youthful. If you tell someone they can look 10 or 20 years younger, they're going to take that look over the natural do nothing look. So on the continuum, do what your provider recommends for you. They have your best interest in mind. You might be at a stage where all you need is topicals. You might need mesotherapy, hyaluronic acid, non-cross-linked injector, just a little bit of plumping and prevention. Or you might need all of that depending on your age and stage and mentally how you want the look. but start slow and build up if it suits you. So a lot about hyaluronic acid. I'd love to hear from you below. No, this was a little bit of a longer video, but it's one of the most important things you can do to maintain youth. And getting injections is absolutely paramount that you see someone you know and trust, because of course they draw water in and you don't want to be overdone or over puffy, especially around the eyes or have a bloated face. Let us know what's your favorite fillers, what's your favorite topicals, and how do you navigate the world of hyaluronic acid? What tips have I missed? Let us know below and join us over on Instagram for similar small videos, clips, but also where people talk from around the world about the subjects that we post there and some of the controversial topics. Subscribe here to keep your skin and body beautiful, healthy, and vibrant.